Praise the Lord. Isn't that the truth tonight? In spite of all of the heartaches and difficulties, and even in spite of what our country is dealing with right now, we can look around and say God has been real, real good to us. I mean, here we stand tonight. If you're saved, heaven is your home. God's your Father. Jesus is your Savior. God's been real good. I'm not going to sing, brother. You might as well shut that off. Praise God. If y'all think I'm going to sing like Brother Kyle, y'all got another thing coming. I can't do it. I'm going to keep my coat on tonight because I'm from South Georgia. And where I come from, I just checked the temperature, and it's 20 to 25 degrees warmer where I'm from than it is right here. You say, preacher, it's only 50-something degrees. Yeah, but the wind's blowing, and my blood is thin. I'm cold. Praise God. So I'm going to preach with my coat on tonight, if you don't mind. And wasn't that good preaching tonight? Well, I thank God for the truth being preached to us. I love Brother Barry. He's been my friend for many, many years. You don't get many friends that you go with through your whole life and your whole ministry. And I trust the Lord's going to let us preach together many years to come. We've been preaching together and been friends for over 15 years. And I thank the Lord for his friendship. We've been all over the place together and preached with each other and for each other. And I thank the Lord. I like somebody that they're the same today as they was when they started. And I can tell you Brother Barry is the same today as he was when he got started. And I appreciate that. You come back tomorrow night. Tomorrow night I'll get up first and give just a little 15, 20 minute sermon. And then Brother Spears is going to preach and use his testimony tomorrow night. He's been requested by Brother Brett and Brother Kyle to preach his testimony. Some of you have not heard it. If you've never heard my friend's testimony, that's one thing that I love about him and makes him unique and God uses him to do. Please come back tomorrow night. If you've got lost family or lost friends or loved ones, everybody needs to hear the story of how God saved this man, changed his life, put his family back together. And if you've never heard it, I promise you will not regret coming tomorrow night. So you'll be here tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. Might want to get here a little bit early. There'll be visitors here tomorrow night just to hear this. So you'll be back early so you can hear that, okay? I want you to take your Bibles this evening and turn to the book of the Psalms with me in chapter number 51. The book of the Psalms in chapter number 51. I promise I'll try and be brief and respect your time. Psalm chapter 51 tonight will be our text. I love how the Holy Ghost can speak to two men's hearts and put them right in the same direction and the same vein. We were at the house earlier today, and Brother Barry looked at me and said, "What are you going to preach?" And I said, "I'm not real sure yet. I'm looking and praying over a couple of things, but my heart was kind of directed in one." I said, "What about you?" He said, "I think I'm preaching on the heart." And I said, "Well, you ain't got a clue, but the one that I was really looking at and thinking about is dealing with the heart." And I'm glad how the Lord puts things like that together. And so evidently and honestly, there must be some hearts tonight that needs to hear some preaching. So I want you to direct your attention to Psalm chapter 51. We'll read two verses of Scripture, but I want you to keep your Bibles open because we're going to be referring back to this text throughout the course of the message. Psalm 51, verse number 10. Psalm 51, verse number 10. David said, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." Come all the way down to verse 17. Look what David said in verse 17. He said, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart." Not a prideful heart, not a puffed up heart, not a cold or a hard heart, but a broken, contrite heart. "Oh God, thou wilt not despise." Psalm chapter number 51 is one of the most honest, broken, burdened pleas and prayers from a heart to God anywhere in the Scriptures. I would say one of the most honest, open-hearted prayers in 66 books of Holy Writ is found in Psalm 51. It is David's personal plea to God for cleansing, for washing, for renewing of broken fellowship, and for God to fix the things that have gone wrong in David's heart tonight. I want to preach on this thought just for a few minutes. I'm preaching on having a heart-to-heart with God. Let's have a heart-to-heart with God. You remember when you was a youngin'? You remember when you was especially around those teenage years and your heart started changing, your life started changing a little bit? And if you was a girl, maybe your mama called you in and said this, or if you was a boy, your daddy called you in. And I can remember having some of these. My daddy would say, "Son, you and me need to have a heart-to-heart. Son, we need to have a heart." And I knew what that meant. I knew that meant we was fixing to get real. We were fixing to get honest. We had no holds barred. We were fixing that he was going to open his heart up to me, and he expected me to open my heart up to him. Here in our text, we find that is what David is doing with his heavenly Father. He is having a heart-to-heart with God tonight. We see a couple of things on the way into the message before we get to the heart to the heart. We see that David's predicament in the text. Look, David's predicament. I don't know if you've got this in your Bible. Most Bibles do. But here in Psalm 51, do you notice at the beginning of the chapter, before David ever writes anything, there is a heading that lets us know what this chapter is about? Well, look at the heading of the chapter. It says this. It said it is a psalm of David when Nathan the prophet came unto him after he had gone in to Bathsheba. Here in the foreword of Psalm 51, we find David is in quite a predicament. You know what's going on right here. Just before David writes this, his sin has been exposed. It has been found out. He has committed adultery with another man's wife. She ends up pregnant by him. And then he murders her husband on the battlefield. And then the preacher comes in before David, and he points his bony finger in front of David's face and said, "David, you've messed up, and thou art the man." I like the fact that Psalm 51 is after the preacher had exposed his sin and preached that David needed to get right. Do you notice Psalm 51 is not David getting soiled up and mad and folding his arms and saying, "Well, I ain't never going back down to Nathan's church again. If Nathan's going to say things like that to me, and if Nathan's going to be rude and ugly like that, and if Nathan's going to make me feel bad about my adultery, and going to make me feel bad about my lust, and going to make me feel bad about my sin, then I'm going to go hunt another church where a preacher will just smile all the time, make me feel good about myself. I can come as I am. I can leave as I came." And no. David said, "I appreciate there was a preacher that exposed my sin so I could get my heart right with God." Let me say this. You ought to appreciate preaching like we just heard tonight. Thank God there's some preachers that'll shine the light of the Word of God on the dark places of our heart so that we might get things right with God. But let me say this. I was sitting there listening to Brother Spears talk about his wife getting shocked. Y'all realize that wasn't comfortable? He said she still bears marks from it today. But listen to me. She wanted her heart right so bad that even if it caused her pain, even if it caused her discomfort, she was willing to let the doctor do what he had to do. Listen, when they went in for that consultation with the doctor, she didn't say, "Hold on now, doc. If you're going to do all that stuff and make me, you know, have some discomfort and some pain, I'm going to get up and I'm going to leave." No. She said, "I know my heart ain't right. And whatever we got to do, whatever you got to say, that's fine." Hey, let me say to Memphis Bible Baptist Church, you ought to thank God you got a pastor that'll stand up and he'll do what he's got to do to keep your heart right with God and to keep your baby's hearts right with God. Brother, thank God there's a man that'll tell you the truth so that you can get your heart right. Don't get mad at preaching. Preaching is designed to keep your heart clean tonight. Here we find David's predicament, but we also see David's personality. David's personality. We always hear it like this. We always hear that David is a man after God's own heart. You want to know why David's a man after God's own heart? I'll tell you why. Because David was a great repenter. David wasn't a perfect man. He messes up a lot of times. But every time he messes up, he's real quick to have a broken heart and to weep and cry and to want to get right. Hey, check this out. I wondered to myself, where is Saul's chapter like Psalm 51? Saul ends up dying backslid. He don't got a Psalm 51. Where is Solomon, David's son? Where's Solomon's Psalm 51? When he got backslid, he ain't got one. But David's got a Psalm 51. David's got a testimony that I got my heart right with God after I messed up tonight. We find David's predicament, David's personality. But here, I want you to notice David's pictures. David makes some pictures about what his heart looks like. David describes to us in picture form what his heart looks like to God. He defines and describes and pictures his sin in several different ways. He lets us know in this text what he wants God to do with this sinful heart of his. I want to show you three things real quick, and we're out of here, as we have a heart-to-heart with God. Number one, David pictures, or David sees his heart as a diary. Some of you young people say, what in the world is a diary? Well, that would be your modern-day term for a journal. Most people don't keep those anymore. I thank God that there's some people that still do and did in the past. Some of the greatest historical documents we have and treasure in our country was simply because people kept a diary. Kept a journal of their daily life. And here we find David said, my heart and my sin is a picture of a diary that has ledgers made in it, that has different marks in it that's messed up. Look what it said down in verse number 1. Look at verse 1 of Psalm 51. Watch what it said. He said, have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. Watch it. Blot out my transgressions. Look down at verse 9. Verse 9. Hide thy face from my sins and blot out all mine iniquities. That term blot out literally means something has been written down. Something has been recorded with pen and ink, and he wants God to erase it. He wants God to white it out. He wants God to remove it from the ledger so that nobody can see it. Listen to me, y'all. When David looks at the entries of his diary, it's some messed up entries in David's diary. When he looks at the entry of his diary, he sees lust in his diary. He was on top of the roof of his house and looked down at that woman. And instead of turning his back and saying, I ain't supposed to look at stuff like that, David lingered and he looked and he lusted and he longed for what he saw. Oh, it wasn't just lust in his diary. We find that there was adultery in his diary. David acted upon the lust that he had in his heart. And then it goes beyond that. It goes to murder in David's diary. He ends up sending her husband to the front of the battle and having the army to withdraw from him and having him murdered. He sees self-righteousness written in his diary. He was really indignant when the preacher came and the preacher gave the illustration of the man that only had one lamb, and the rich man with all the lambs took the one poor man's lamb. David said, that sorry sucker ought to die. That sorry sucker's good for nothing. And the man said, David, that's you. You're a hypocrite. You're self-righteous. You're pointing one finger at that guy, but you got four fingers pointed back at yourself, David. When David looks at his diary, David's diary at this point in his life, it doesn't look like the diary of the old David. The old David had entries of worship and entries of praise and entries of glory to God. But at this point, David's diary is reading totally different. David's diary is a dark, depressing, sinful written diary at this point. We see not only is his heart a diary, but his heart was dirty. Look what he says in verse 2. Look at verse 2. The first part of verse 2. Wash me throughly. I like that word, throughly. It means all the way through one side and back to the other. Wash me throughly from mine iniquity. Look at the last part of verse 7. The very last part of verse 7. He said, wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. David said, my heart's gotten dirty. I've just got no nasty smut up in my heart. I don't only see my heart as a diary. I see it as being dirty. Can I say this? David sees his heart like most Americans never see their heart. Yeah. We say things like this. We say things like this. It almost makes me sick. They say, well, everybody's good down in their heart. I beg to differ. The Bible said the heart is desperately wicked, deceitfully wicked above all things. Who can know it tonight? That's your heart and your wife's heart and your husband's heart and your granny's heart and your papa's heart and your children's heart and your youngest's heart. I mean, brother, that old heart, if you let it go, it'll mess you up. It's dirty tonight. Let me say this to every American listening in the parking lot and on Facebook tonight. If America would wash our hearts half as much as the government is wanting us to wash our hands, we'd have revival in this nation. Some of y'all 10 times more concerned about Purell in your hands and sanitizing your hands. But what we really need is a sanitizing of our heart. What we really need is a washing of the filth of our heart tonight. Hey, some of y'all, you wash your hands 10 times a day, and it's been years since you washed your heart of the filthiness that's in it. God help you. I'm a whole lot more concerned of the virus of sin than I am the virus of corona tonight. Yeah, he saw his heart is dirty. I say this to you. My son likes to ride motocross. I like to ride it too. I got a bike. He's got a bike. On the weekends, I know I'm going to take him to ride dirt bikes and motocross. On a particular Saturday, I didn't take my bike. I was tired and didn't want to ride, so I just took him. Brother Kyle, we got out there to the track, and I didn't do nothing but unload his bike, get it ready, and let him go ride. I stood out there beside the track and coached him and taught him and trained him, and I just watched. It was real dusty that day. It was windy, and the dust from the track was blowing everywhere. I didn't ride. I didn't put on boots. I didn't put on a helmet or goggles. I just stood there and watched. Didn't even participate. I got home that day, walked in my house, and I told my wife, I said, I feel dirty. I feel as nasty as if I was out there riding. I said, I didn't even do nothing. I said, Tristan, I'm going to get a shower. Out there where we rode at, it was a clay track. That clay dust was all in the air. I went in that shower, that white shower, and I'll never forget turning the water on, Brother Moore. And when that hot water started hitting me, I remember I let my eyes drop. And I thought I was melting, praise God. I mean, the water instantly turned orange. I mean, from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet, stuff just started coming off, and the water literally turned orange for about 30, 40 seconds till it washed off of me. You know what I realized? I didn't even have to participate in what they were doing. I was just around it, and it got on me. I was just there, and it got on me. Now, y'all listen to me. I know you come to church, and I know many of you read your Bible and pray, and you don't got to be committing adultery or murder or lust or drunkenness or doing drugs or whatever, but just living in this world, it's all around us, and it gets us dirty, and if you don't get washed up on a regular basis, it'll be all over you tonight. Having a heart-to-heart with God. His heart was a diary. His heart was dirty. His heart was diseased. Look at what he said in verses 2 and verses 7. The last part of verse 2, he said this. He not only said, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, but then he says something else about his heart. He said, and cleanse me from my sin. Look at the first part of verse 7. He said, purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Y'all, don't miss this. Washing is for the outside, but cleansing is for the inside. David said, not only do I need to be washed, but I need to be cleansed. That cleansing and that purging, it literally is dealing with a disease that gets on the inside. That it's the picture of leprosy. You know what leprosy was over in Leviticus and throughout the Bible? Leprosy was something that starts on the inside, but then it works its way to the outside, and then it kills the victim that is infected by it. David said, not only do I need my sin to be washed because I'm dirty, but I need my sin to be cleansed because it's eating away at me, and it's killing me, and it has ate away my joy. It has ate away my song. It has ate away my worship. It has ate away my peace. I can't even lay my head on my bed at night and get a good night's sleep for knowing what I've done and what I've become. And God, I need you to purge off this iniquity and this disease from my heart. So we're having a heart-to-heart with God. So here we are. You say, preacher, you... David tells us. He says, for the diary, the heart that's a dirty diary, the heart that's got messed up things in it. Look what he said in verse 1. He says it in verse 1 and verse 9. We'll just read verse 1. He said, have mercy on me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. I love how he said this. Blot out my transgressions. David said, I want you to erase them. Blot them out. I got to thinking about that blotting out business, Brother Spears. Here just a year or so ago, we come through it for about 2 years. Now it's being recycled again. All of this Trump-Russia collusion and all these different individuals and spies and spy rings and all this stuff. And do you remember when they were going through all that? They would say, well, here are these documents. And you'd see them on Fox and CNN and MSNBC. But they would say this. They'd say, but they are heavily redacted. Y'all remember that? And it would show the documents, but they didn't make a lot of sense. Because it would start talking and then there'd just be a big long black blot. And you couldn't tell who it was talking about or what they'd done or where they'd been. I said, well, that was pointless to look at. It was so heavily redacted, all the good stuff was gone. All the dirty stuff was gone. And all the people that you could tie it to had been blotted out. You couldn't even see it no more. David said, God, this is what I want you to do. God, I want you to redact the document. I want you to redact the diary. And God, all those things that's been written down in heaven, God, I'm asking you to blot them out so you don't see them no more. I'm glad to report to you tonight, friend, when a brokenhearted individual comes before the throne room of grace and gets his heart right, there's a God in heaven that takes the blood of Calvary and redacts the sin and blots it out and cleanses it, and God sees it no more and God remembers it no more. You can get your diary redacted tonight. What sins are you talking about? I don't remember them anymore. From the book of life, they've all been torn out, and I don't remember them anymore. You say, preacher, my diary reads real bad. Yeah, but there's a God that can blot it out tonight. You see, not only did the diary get blotted out, but then he sees his heart was dirty. I told you his heart was dirty. Look what he says about this dirty heart. Verse number 2, he said, wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity. The last part of verse 7, he says, wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. You say, preacher, all this is talking about is just getting some soap out, washing yourself. But no, it's more than that. I look this word, wash, up. It's mentioned in verse 2 and verse 7. This word wash. And you know what I found out? It's tied to a thing in the Bible that's only mentioned a couple of times. It's tied to what is called the fuller or the fuller's soap. Do you know what a fuller was in these days? The fuller was basically the laundry man. He was the one that would take garments that had stains in them. dark garments that got dirty and nobody else could get the stains out. And the fuller would take them to where he had shops set up at. They said that fuller would take a certain type of chemicals that he had. And they said this, they said those chemicals even smelled offensive. They put a weird odor out. He said they would put those chemicals in and wash them. And then if it was extreme enough, the fuller would step on those garments and move them with his feet to be able to get all the nastiness out. He would literally have to put them under the feet. You say, preacher, that's really messed up. Somebody would stomp on clothes and somebody put them chemicals on clothes. Yeah, but if you want the stain out bad enough, you'll let the fuller do whatever he's got to do to get it out. No length was too extreme. No length was too great. If you wanted your garment clean, can I just take a time out and say the problem with a lot of people is they really don't want to get clean tonight. They want partial cleansing, but they don't want a full washing tonight. They just want a little dab, or do you? Get a little bit of religion. Get a little case of the do-betters. God's not in the business of that. He wants to take your life and do whatever he's got to do. And if that means God's got to stomp it, let God stomp it. If that means God's got to purge it, let God purge it. But let God do the full cleansing of the heart tonight. It may hurt. It may be a little bit different. But let God do it, friend. His heart was a diary. His heart was dirty. And lastly, we see that his heart was diseased. How in the world are we going to get a diseased heart fixed, preacher? It's mentioned here in the text. Look at what he said at the first part of verse 7. Purge me with hyssop. Don't miss that. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. This gives us in some insight tonight. That word hyssop is literally, go back to the Old Testament over in Leviticus and places like that, and you'll find that hyssop was used around the tabernacle. They said hyssop was a plant that was used for medicinal purposes, and it was connected with the cleansing of the temple. But that ain't what really caught my eye. You know what really caught my eye and what this is really connected to? It's connected with something that can cleanse the diseased heart of man. But it's not just connected with something, it's connected with someone that can cleanse the diseased heart. You know where the last time the word hyssop is mentioned at? It's mentioned in the book of John, chapter number 19. I'm going to read it and we're going to be done. John 19 and verse number 29. Or verse 28 said, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, saith, I thirst. Now there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar, and put it upon hyssop, and put it to his mouth. Can I tell y'all tonight, nothing cleanses the diseased heart of man like Jesus does. Nothing cleanses the diseased heart of man like a trip to the cross of Calvary does. When David said, purge me with hyssop, it takes you all the way into the future from David and all the way into the past for us, to a lonely hill called Golgotha, where the Son of God suffered, shed blood, and died for the sins and the disease of all humanity. And any man, woman, boy, or girl that'll kneel at the cross, Christ will meet them there. And the disease that fell upon Adam's race can be purged, can be lifted, can be expunged, can be cleaned, and the heart can get right tonight. I'm glad there's a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath the flood, lose all their guilty stains tonight. And if you're lost and never been born again, your diseased heart can get purged. And if you're a child of God, that some things has gotten up in your heart like the preacher preached about, your heart can be cleansed tonight. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. Help me, Brother Kyle. And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I simply preached on having a heart to heart with God.